going to be the ophthalmoscope. The ophthalmoscope needs to be something that's going to fit good in your hands because you're going to be the one using it. The other thing that's going to be key is that you want to be able to maneuver between the apertures and the filters and the diopter wheel very easily. The last thing you want to do is pull away from that patient's eye and have that pupil close down on you as you come back in. It would be very difficult for you. When you look through the ophthalmoscope, it is the only time that you actually can see the back of the eye or the fundus in its natural state. So let's look at the ophthalmoscope a little bit closer. As you can see on the front, you have your aperture wheel, where it's going to control your spot sizes. Up front here, you've got your polarizing filter. Let's just say you have a cataract or a buildup on the front of the eye and you need to blast through it. You have that ability now by clicking amongst these different filters. The next thing is you want to be able to maneuver through the diopter wheel very, very easily. There's a lot of lenses and there's a lot of things going on here. So you want to make sure you're getting something from a quality manufacturer. The schools have made certain that all the quality manufacturers are present here. So on the ophthalmoscope, how do we use it? How do we handle our instrument? Well, first off, the ophthalmoscope itself, all the lamps are located right in the neck of the ophthalmoscope or of the head. We then place it on the handle and rotate it. We need to turn it on. What's nice when you put the ophthalmoscope head on, it's nice to have the power button facing you as a practitioner. And then you can quickly just rotate, turn the light on, and grab it. Most people grab down here, some people grab too high. You want to get something where you can maneuver your hand all the way over to the diopters, to the different filters and different apertures that are located on the ophthalmoscope. The easier you can maneuver, the better off you're going to be, and the better off your patient's going to be, truthfully. Okay, so let's show you how you kind of set up when you use the ophthalmoscope. When you come to the tabletops and you're at the school and you're trying to figure out what's going on, here's what you need to do. First off, make sure it's on. Next thing we want to do is we want to flash the light at the eye. We want to see the red reflex. But before we do that, let's put this against our brow and let's focus in the distance, usually about 10 feet away. Make sure we've got it in focus. Notice my finger right here as I move the diopter wheel as I get it in focus. Once I've got that in focus, and if I do not know the patient's script, which I probably won't, I will then line up the red reflex and come in at an angle. The patient will always be staring over my ear, if you will. I come in at an angle and I follow this red reflex on in. As I come in and see the fundus, oh my God, son, you need some help. I'm just kidding. And we pull away. Now, again, if I needed to use any of the filters, if I was getting too much glare, or if there's something in the way, I need to be able to maneuver very quickly. One of the other ophthalmoscopes that are on the market is called the panoptic ophthalmoscope. This is something my wife happens to use, especially with kids, when she needs to get a nice view quickly. Now you can see this is a much larger instrument than the regular ophthalmoscope. And due to that length, we want to move slow, because a little move is going to mean a lot when it comes to the panoptic. Again, we need to make sure our handle's turned on. And then you'll notice on the end, this is going to rest on the patient's brow. Once we get our view, you'll notice I'll push in, and this is just so I get the big effect of the panoptic ophthalmoscope. This is going to be my practitioner side, and then just like we were using the lens wheel before on the regular ophthalmoscope, we'll be using this focusing wheel. Just like with the other one with the apertures on the front, they're located right here. Again, very key to be able to maneuver amongst these while you're looking in the back of the eye. All right, you ready?
Yes.
Okay, again, I'm going to focus at a distance. Once I've done that, I will now come in and get the red reflex. The first thing I'm going to notice is this is not as bright as the regular ophthalmoscope. So what I will need to do is I'm going to come closer, because as I get closer, the light gets brighter. Grab my red reflex, which looks barely there. Now there's the red reflex. Now I'm coming in. It's nice and in focus. There's the disc. I've got everything here. I can now push in, and I've got a big view. Okay, sir, you're going to go to ER. Just kidding. But very simple, and that's the main thing, and quick. And with kids, you might need to be fast, something you should look at. So we just saw me use the panoptic ophthalmoscope with the eye cup. Some of the optometrists out there have showed us how to use it without the eye cup. Again, this can be used very quickly in an undilated eye. You can, I don't know if you can see this on the film, but we can get down to a small, small size, a BB size, to get in those small, small pupils, which is very helpful with geriatric patients. Now, without the eye cup, I will rest my fingers on the patient's brow. I will now look through, and I will use my fingers as a gauge so I can still get my view. And again, if I go to move, I want to kind of pivot, and I do not want to move the front end of the scope as I'm looking around the fundus. Nice job. And that's it. Another simple instrument. There's one other piece that does come with this. It's called a corneal viewing lens. All it does is magnify. And if you didn't have something to use or looking for abrasions or cuts in the eye, you could use it. There'll be other instruments that you'll have that will do a better job.